So I hope you all are having a great Sunday today, and I'm sure that your children also would be having a great time with you all today, enjoying with parents, because they always look forward to, you know, spend time with parents on their holidays, basically, that is Sunday, so when they have their weekly off. So yes, for all the working parents, this is the day when time with their children. And so yes, Learning Pie is yet back again with the very interesting topic. Oh, hi Riddhi.
Yes, hi, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Great, great, great. Finally we made it. Not
doing
well, and I was so worried because, you know, I said yes to you. Until yesterday, I was not in a very good shape. But I'm glad that I'm feeling much better now.
Yes, I'm glad that you joined, and I am glad to know this, that you're feeling much better now.
Yes, yes, much better.
Great, great. So I was just briefing people about you, basically, that today's topic, as everybody knows, that today's topic is on working moms, which is a very important topic, you know. And being working moms, they tend to, you know, ignore themselves, like they don't take care of themselves and how they should balance their work life and personal life. So this is what our topic is. So before that, I would like to introduce our guest today. I welcome you again, Riddhi. So Riddhi Deora is basically a parenting coach, and she is an influencer and popularly known as Mom on Skates, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So she creates several parenting courses such as mindful and active parenting, easy stress management, etc. So she also hosts parenting classes across the globe and conducts workshops. So I welcome you, Riddhi. And as we have picked up a very interesting topic for our, especially for our working moms. So I would just pour in some questions so that you can answer for our guests and our viewers, right, who are there to see you.
Right.
Okay. So my first question is, how should working mothers strike work-life balance?
Right. So that's a great one. So actually, this would depend on what stage of motherhood are you in. So if you're a new mom, it would be a little more challenging for you because your commitment towards your child would be a little more. But then again, you know, there's something called work-life integration is what I follow. So, you know, there's one is work-life balance, and then the other is work-life integration. And now I'm going to explain what is the difference between the two. So when you talk about work-life balance, it means that you treat work and your life as two independent things, right? So once you're done working, that's when you start giving life to your, start giving space and time to your family or your child. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you're dividing the two and treating them as two separate things. And then there's work-life integration, which I feel works better for mothers, especially where you're treating work and your life as one whole. So, you know, whatever requires more of you, you are available for that piece. And then you take charge of the other things. So let's say, you know, I'm a working parent, but I'm following work-life integration for the last 4 years since I've delivered Veer. Because Veer is my son, for those who don't know. So
yeah, I've seen this photograph, and that's very cute, I must say. I've seen this photograph.
Yes. Yeah. And I feel that really works well for me because, you know, when I need to be there for my child, I'm there for him. When I need to be there for my work, I'm there for him. But sometimes, yes, of course, it can get challenging. You have to be at work and you cannot be there for your child all the time. But then the strategy that works the best is that, you know, live in the moment. So for me, this is possible. For a lot of us, this is possible. For those who are working professionals, it can be challenging because if you have an important meeting at work, it is challenging for you to leave that meeting and be there for your child, right? So for you, I feel that, you know, living in the moment is what works the best. And this is something that I experienced a lot because I had a retail outlet. So I had to go to the store and, you know, I had to leave my baby at home. And, you know, when I was at work, I constantly kept thinking about my child. And when I was with my child, I kept thinking about things at work. and this really takes a toll on your toll on you mentally, and also starts to show up physically on your body. You know, you'll start feeling feverish, you'll feel more fatigued, you'll feel exhausted, and it'll start showing up. So I feel living in the moment is the best thing. So when you're at work, don't worry too much about your child, or don't worry too much. Just 1 second, I'm going to put the AC on. I just took the medicine and now I'm sweating.
Sure, no problem.
Yeah. So when you're with your child, you're constantly thinking about your work, but you're not getting much done at work then. And when you're at work and constantly thinking about your child, you're not being with your child anyway, right? So you're not getting anything done properly. So if you're at work, be 100% at work. Don't feel guilty. It is very easy for us mothers to feel guilty about everything. When you're at work, look at it as an opportunity, you know, opportunity for letting your child meet other people. Look at it as an opportunity for your child to become more independent. Look at it as an opportunity for your child to understand different environments, right? So don't feel guilty about, you know, leaving your child. Because, you know, what are we doing? You can never leave your child, right? At any point. And, you know, no matter where you go, you always carry your child with you. So instead of feeling guilty about the whole process, understand who are you doing this for. You're always doing this for your child. You know, when you make that list of priorities, your child would come first. You know, maybe you're doing it because it makes you feel good. That could be number one. And then number two is, you know, what are you going to do with all that you make? You're going to give it to your child or your family, right? So there's no and look at it as an opportunity for letting your child grow. So when you change the way you look at it, then a lot of guilt gets taken care of. So I feel that is very important. Live in the moment, do your best, and see what works better for you. So for some of us, it's work-life balance. For some of us, it's work-life integration. Because some of us feel very difficult to switch between the two roles, you know. So if you are finding it difficult to switch and it's getting more frustrating and irritating for you, then you follow the work-life balance. If you feel that you're very easy with the switch, like it's very easy for you to be on the laptop and then be with your child and then come back to your laptop, if that is something that's working more efficiently for you, then you follow that method. So whatever it is that works for you, you can try both the techniques and see what works for you. That's one. And then the second thing is to, of course, have a plan. That is really, really important. To have a plan and plan it on the calendar. Don't make a to-do list, because the problem with a to-do list is that, you know, there's no time to it. So you sometimes tend to overspend and more time than is necessary on completing a particular activity. So it's very important that you have it on a calendar and plan something which is more realistic. Sometimes we have this habit of over expecting too much from ourselves, and we tend to put a lot more on our calendar than we can actually achieve, and that makes it more difficult for us. And at the end of the day, when we look at our calendar and we've not done most of it, we feel like, you know, we've not achieved enough, and we sleep with a sense of dissatisfaction even after working a lot. So I feel the idea of making a plan is to actually make yourself feel better and to actually make yourself feel more comfortable and efficient, instead of, you know, you feeling guilty about not being able to do enough. So having said that, I don't mean that don't put anything on the calendar. Of course, you know, it should be challenging, but it should not be something that's, you know, testing your limits every single day. This is what I personally do. So I plan, I follow Jeff Bezos. So I follow only 3 very important things on my calendar, like 3 very needle moving things on my calendar, and the rest is simple, and I take it as the day flows. So I think if you do these things, I think you're pretty much sorted.
Yes. Right. So I have a question. Like, we all women have been raised in such a way that we have always been taught that we have so many responsibilities around us, and, you know, playing so many roles and multitasking, and whether we have any help or not, but all the responsibilities are on our shoulders. So keeping that in mind, if I think mostly that is the thing which brings the guilt to the mothers when they are not able to, especially working mothers, when they think that they are not able to spend the quality time at home with their children or the family, or not able to, you know, cope with the responsibilities that they have been so taught since the beginning of their, you know, adulthood. So what do you think that how should they deal with this and, you know, not feel guilty basically about it? Because time has changed, so has a lot of things around, you know.
Right, right. Yes. Yeah. So before I take your question, I'd just like to respond to Shruti. She's saying, still your AC is off. Yes, Shruti, I just turned the fan on instead. And so I'll just tell you how I feel this could work. So it's basically, you know, like what happens is that sometimes, like, guilt is something that, you know, is inside, and it comes when you're over expecting too much from yourself. So whenever you're over expecting too much from others and those needs are not met, your expectations are not met, it would lead to frustration. But when you're over expecting too much from yourself and when you cannot meet those expectations, it would lead to guilt. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. So now it's all about having realistic expectations from yourself. And the understanding that, you know, there'll always be people who'll complain and who'll point a finger at you and who'll have things to say and who'll have opinions of you.
Absolutely.
But something very beautiful that my mentor also says, it's not about what people tell you. It's about what you tell yourself about when people have stopped telling you what they have to tell you. So, you know, if I can tell you that, you know, you're not as pretty, you know, if somebody tells me that, you know, you're not very pretty, you know, and if I accept it, then, you know, that's when it's going to affect me. But if somebody tells me that you're not pretty and I don't absorb it, and I tell myself a different story after the person is done telling me what he or she has to tell me, then, you know, I'm going to feel a different way. So I feel that, yes, as working mothers, you have to understand that, of course, there are going to be people in your environment who are going to actually give you your reason, give reasons for you to stop doing what you're doing. And honestly, the same people would actually also have an opinion once you stop doing what you're doing, you know. So they'll always have an opinion irrespective of whether you're working or not working. And this is something that I've learned over the last 6-7 years that, you know, people who have opinion, they have an opinion irrespective of what you're doing. If you're working, they'll have an opinion. If you're not working, they'll still have an opinion. You know, if you're not working, they'll be like, you know, you've studied so much, I think you should be working. And if you're not, so, you know, it's all about how you train your mind and what is it that you absorb and what is it that you reject. And of course, this is something that's not going to happen immediately. But over a period of time, you'll also understand that, you know, it's no use paying too much attention to all of this. So that is one, you know, when people are constantly feeding you information, I would recommend that don't absorb it completely. And, you know, and if you feel that there is something, some honesty about what, about the feedback, it's been given to you with a good intent and you understand that the intent is not wrong and what they mean is actually making sense to you, then you see what is it that you can do. Sometimes with kids, if you cannot find enough time during the weekdays, find time during the weekends. So that's what I do with my sons. You know, during the weekdays, sometimes it's very difficult for me to get his school tasks done. Right? So if sometimes if I don't, maybe Thursdays are very busy and I cannot get it done on a Thursday. But, you know, the weekends are more free. So I make sure that whatever needs to be done is done. Maybe it's not happening exactly when it has to happen, you know. So it's more about like, you know, getting everything done and not feeling guilty about not doing anything. So if you're missing it on Thursday, does not mean that you've missed it completely. You still have time. So instead of beating yourself up for not being able to do it on Thursday, so what most of us do is that, you know, Thursday missed, it means that the assignment is gone forever. There's no scope for you to do it because you missed the day. So I think instead of following that approach, if Thursday is gone, that's okay. But you still have time with your child. Your child is still there. So you can still get the assignment done, right? So it's all about how you spread it across your week and see where to fit what. and how it works for you. So, you know, find some time for your husband. Very important, I feel. You know, once we become parents, especially if you're a working parent, your first thing is, you know, getting work done, then also going to your child, and then husband comes last on your list. So find time for your husband, find time for your child, and see, like, you know, plan your calendar in a way that every week you have some time for your husband, some time for your child, some time for your in-laws if you're living with your in-laws. And so if you have it planned, it becomes it becomes very easy, and you'll not feel guilty because you are going to meet whatever it is that you've planned. So I feel like, you know, for me, every Sunday I spend at least 1 hour with my son without any phone or anything in the garden. So, you know, I feel very happy about that 1 hour, and we do some pretend play, we do some picnic or something, you know, like we make a tent or something we do every Sunday, or we just play with the ball, or I'm just reading, he's reading his books. So 1 hour is just, you know, time for the two of us. So it's great. Fridays, I usually try to do dinner with my husband or a movie night with my husband. So I feel good that at least I spend some time with my husband every week. So just like that, you have to figure out what is it that you can do. Like with my mother-in-law, we're not like staying together, but I make sure that I call her every single day. So, you know, even if it's not for too long, even if it's for 5 to 10 minutes every day, sometimes it's longer. But, you know, it's just that you're staying connected and you're finding time for them. And that is going to make you feel very good. And when you feel that you've taken care of everything else, your productivity at work also increases, I feel. Because for women, I feel no matter how ambitious you are, I could be wrong, but this is what I've felt with all the women that I've interacted with and for myself, that you could be very ambitious, but as long as you've not taken care of your family, you will not be very productive at work. Because you'll constantly keep going back to your family. But if you've taken care of your family, if you've taken care of your husband, your child and your in-laws, and you feel that they are content and happy, your efficiency at work would be very high. You'll also enjoy your work a lot more. So for me, it happens, you know, for 2 days, if I start feeling that, you know, I'm not giving enough time to my child or my husband, I see my efficiency and productivity dipping, you know, because my focus keeps going back to them. So that's when I realized that it's time for me to actually spend some more quality time with them. So I feel it's very important that you do that. Take care of your family members. Do something, you know, like a ritual. It can be like a ritual so that you don't have to keep planning it over and over again. And once you have done that, then you can actually be more efficient and productive at work.
So it's basically that ease out a little and just go with the flow.
Yeah, exactly. Ease out, make small plans. Yeah, right. Correct. Lovely. Great. Okay.
So my next question is that as mothers, they play many roles and they do multitasking, and they take care of everyone. And as we have discussed this, so how should they take care of themselves and understand the importance of that, that how important it is to take care of themselves as well?
Right.
What they should basically do that.
Right. That's a beautiful, beautiful question. And this is like the first thing on my list, self-care. It's super important because unless you are filling yourself up, you cannot really give to others. So don't look at self-care as in, you know, again, you know, we start feeling guilty about doing things for ourselves. But sometimes I feel it's a combination of guilt and laziness. It's not always guilt. It's also that, you know, we are very lazy when it comes to doing things for ourselves, but we are not lazy when it comes to doing things for others. And the reason is that we don't give enough importance to ourselves. So, you know, like if my husband is home and if I have to cook for him, I'll not be lazy at all. You know, I'll immediately go to the kitchen, I'll make a nice meal for him and give it to him. But if I'm alone at home, I'll be like, you know, who's going to make a whole meal right now? Just for myself, I'm better have something else. You know, I'll have something that you can have a fruit maybe, but I'll not take that whole effort to actually make a whole meal for myself. So it's about not just about being guilty, but also about being lazy when it comes to ourselves. So I think self-care is so important because it is the root cause of all the triggers, especially as a mother. You know, you get irritated, you start shouting, or you start your tolerance is very low. And all of that happens because you're not doing anything for yourself and you're expected to do so much for others. And that's when it all, you know, so there's a very beautiful example that I always share. I've been sharing it for the last 3-4 lives, but I would like to share here also because I think we have some new audience. So let's say you have a bank account and your bank account has 5 lakh rupees in it, right? And now somebody from your family comes and they'll ask you for 10,000 rupees. So when they ask you for 10,000 rupees, because you're sitting at 5 lakh, you'll not feel any pain while giving that 10,000 rupees to them. You'll be like, yeah, yeah, please take it. You need it more than I do. And you're going to give them the 10,000 rupees. After some time, what happens is you're sitting at 450. Let's say they've come 4-5 times in between. And now you're at 4,50,000. There's no inflow happening, only outflow, right? So now they come when you're at 450 and they ask you for another 10,000. You give it to them. After some time, you're sitting at 2 lakh and now you're thinking a little, right? Now, because you don't have enough left, you're just at 2 lakh, but they're still asking you. And since they are close to you and you've been giving them a yes for so long, they're used to listening to that yes. And you have also become very used to saying yes. So it's difficult for you to say no. It's difficult for them to take no as a response. And you're like, okay, I'm going to give you this 10,000 rupees, even though I'm at 2 lakh. But you're still thinking now a little, right? You give that 10,000 rupees to them. So now you're at 190. And then there comes a time when you're at 10,000. But now you're at 10,000. But because you have come, you are so habituated to saying yes, you're not going to say no. And now because they are so confident that you'll not say no, they only want a yes from you. And because they are your family, it's difficult for you to say no. So you're going to give 10,000. But this time when you give this 10,000 to them, it's going to be very stressful for you. It's not going to be very easy, right? Because now you don't have anything left for yourself. And then there'll be a point where you have to actually take loan to give. Right? Now you're actually taking loan from outside to provide for them. Right? So this is how our body is. You know, we have a certain amount of energy. And in the beginning, when our energy is very high, we don't mind giving away, right? We are giving more and more. Okay. And then, you know, in between when your energy is depleting, then the giving becomes a little more uncomfortable. And there comes a point where the energy is so low that, you know, giving can actually become a cause of danger for you. You know, it might not be very easy for you to give because now you're having to take loan. So this is why self-care is important, because we all have a certain level of energy and all of us like to give. All of us are givers and we are giving, but if you're not refilling, then it's very difficult for you to give for too long with the same level of happiness. So that's what happens with parenting and motherhood, I feel. Initially, when your baby has just arrived, you're so excited. The baby is so small. You're all about giving and taking care of the baby. But now what is happening is that you're constantly giving and you're not giving yourself anything. You're not refilling. So then there's going to come a point where you really break down. And you know, you're like, oh my God, this is crazy. I just cannot. What did I do? Or, you know, I cannot tolerate this. And they say they're terrible threes. And I think the terrible threes has a lot to do with the kids and a lot to do with the parents also. Because if the parents are not taking care of themselves for 3 years, after 3 years, they are so exhausted and they are so drained out that, you know, anything small will also start to look terrible.
Absolutely.
Right? So it's not just to do with the children. I feel it's also to do with your personal exhaustion level. And you can easily avoid this by actually following a self-care routine, which I feel is very, very important for all of us to do. And it's going to change everything for you. You're going to feel more calm, more patient. The anger would be less. The triggers would be delayed, postponed, or might not happen for you. And there's so, and your productivity at work would be higher. And you'll be able to manage your day much more efficiently. So I think self-care is extremely, extremely important. And it does not take too much time. And for those who think that they don't have time for self-care, it's just about how high it is on your list of priorities. If it's high, you'll find time for it, right? Just like we find time for food, sleep, shower, everything, right? and doesn't yeah. have to be too long, right? If you're just starting off, start with 15-20 minutes. Don't have to mm-hmm. start with like 1 hour, 1.5 hour. You can just start with 15-20 minutes and then slowly build up, I think. And right. extremely important, I feel. Yes.
Yeah, so basically this should not be ignored and kept in mind. Definitely, it's very important.
And
very important.
And don't feel that, there's no need to feel guilty, I feel. It's about looking at it again as an opportunity to be able to provide more of yourself to everyone for a really long period of time with a sense of joy. Right. Right? Without having the feeling that you're being forced to do all of this. So if you right. are actually finding that 10, 15 minutes or 20 minutes for self-care, you will be able to provide much more to your family with a sense of joy and inspiration rather than a sense of being forced to do it.
Yeah, so it's important to take care of yourself first so that you can give it, you know.
Exactly.
You need to, yeah, you need to be full to be empty, basically, to give
exactly.
it to others.
Wow, yes. That's true.
Great. Okay, so my next question is now when this pandemic is going on and a lot of children, in fact, everyone is having only online classes right now. And there are many children who haven't even been to any kind of online programming or any online classes or any formal learning. Okay, so now this has started happening. So parents, like working mothers especially, they find it difficult to balance it that because of the online classes, if the online classes of the child are going on at home, they can't give time to the child for that because they have to go to the offices and, you know, for their work and all. So how should they cope with this and balance this and work on this so that even the learning of the child continues and the mothers are also, you know, at ease or
right.
they can
right.
also work.
So I think that if your child is 4 and above, there's no need yeah. for you as a parent to sit with your child. Like you can mm-hmm. easily train your child with the basics, you know, about how to mute, unmute and put the video on, put the video off. Because right. anyway, during the online classes, they don't really have to type in anything. It's just about, you know, muting yourself and unmuting whenever the teacher requests you to do that. Mm-hmm. So 4 and above, I feel as a parent, you can easily train them how to do it, have a few test rounds with them on how to mute, unmute, turn the video on and off. Video on and off okay. is also something that's not required. Once it's on, you can just leave it on. But the mute, unmute yes. thing, you really need to teach. So once you've done that, I think 4 and above, you don't have to sit next to your child. Just pretend that you're sending your child to a physical school. That's what I do now. And okay. I feel it's working better for me. Some kids, you know, the temperament of the child might differ. You know, some kids might not sit at all. So provide a distraction-free environment where there's not too many, you know, too many things lying around the child for the child mm-hmm. to get distracted easily. So mm-hmm. make sure that the space, the spot is the same spot. It should be like a neat table with just a chair and mm-hmm. the laptop. And right. no distractions. Same place so that, you know, child can identify that spot as his school. And then mm-hmm. you just leave the child in the room with his laptop and let him enjoy what's happening. Because even if he's moving around, he's at least listening to what's happening.
Right.
So right. just because, you know, even when our children go to school, we're not really there to see what they're doing. Right. And now yeah. we've taken this extra role of actually seeing what's happening inside the school, which is actually causing a lot of trouble to both the children and the parents, I feel. So it's yeah. best if you're not involved in the whole process. Just let the child be. Make sure all the things that are required, the schools usually let you know in advance that, you know, the child needs to sit with so-and-so mm-hmm. paper and this scissor and the glue and everything. So just check yeah. everything a day in advance. Make sure everything is there and put it in front of the desk. So 4 and above, I don't think it's required. 4 and below, I think, yes, you mm-hmm. might have to sit with your child. So in that case, it's better to inform your workplace that, you know, I'll not be able to take any urgent meetings from 9 to 12. Because I think 4 and below, the classes are maximum for 1, 1.5 hours.
Morning, yeah.
And it's not more than that. I think for Veer, it right. was only 40 minutes. So it's not yes. more than an hour when it's 4 and below. 4 mm-hmm. and above is when the duration also increases. And I feel then by then they are more independent to sit, you know, they're more independent and they can sit alone.
So 4 and below, when it's just 1 hour, I think it makes sense to communicate it to your workplace that, you know, this is for 1 hour, I'll not be able to take any important meeting. Before and after, I'm okay. And once you've communicated it very strongly, then it becomes very easy for you, because every day you're not going through this power struggle of not being available from 9 to 10 or 10 to 11. And you can tell them that, you know, whatever work needs to be done for that 1 hour, I can compensate for it later.